This PC Build series is brought to you by Antec, Apotop, and Patriot Memory. Hello everybody, it's Brian for GadgetUnit.com, and in this video it's time for part 15 of my $500 triple boot PC build series. In this final video we'll be doing some graphics benchmarks, an SSD benchmark, as well as some gaming tests. So the first one will be the Unigine Tropics demo. We'll also be looking at the other three Unigine demos. So the settings for this one are maxed out, except that anti-aliasing is set to 2x instead of 4x or higher. So, as you can see now, in the actual benchmark, we are getting some pretty respectable frame rates, anywhere from 30 to 50 FPS, with an average of just about 40. So that is not too bad. The next benchmark was Unigine's Sanctuary benchmark. Again, this one was maxed out, though anti-aliasing was kept to 2x. And for this one, it was pretty much the same deal, maybe a little bit less. This one is a little bit more graphically demanding than the Tropics demo, but this one wasn't too bad, though. In fact, our average FPS was actually a little bit higher than the Tropics demo. One thing to note is the video card temperatures are actually pretty good. I've never exceeded more than 65 degrees Celsius, which is very respectable. Once we hit more than 70 or 80, that's when you should start worrying a little bit about your different cooling options, but the GT740 by MSI can certainly stay fairly cool under load. The next demo is Unigine's Valley benchmark. To me, this is the favorite of mine because it just looks the best visually. Just the different environments and sort of the mountains in the background, the way the flowers look under different lighting conditions. To me, this one is definitely the prettiest. And it compared to the other two, it's definitely more taxing on the hardware. So you can see that our average FPS was 18.2 with a minimum of 11 with a maximum of 33. So for this one, we would probably want to bring down the settings a little bit. It is being run at the ultra quality setting with 2x and 8a, so we may want to bring that down if you want a better frame rate. And finally, we ran the Unigine Heaven benchmark, which is definitely the most graphically intensive. So for the start, as you can tell, everything is maxed out, including 2x anti-aliasing, full screen at 1920 by 1080. And you can see that our frame rate is not that good, so less than 10 FPS or so at the beginning of it, though some scenes were noticeably smoother. So our average FPS for this was 13.7 with a minimum of 5.1 and a maximum of 32.5. And again, everything was maxed out for this one, including tessellation and of course our general quality setting. Now before I move on to the gaming tests, here we are doing an Atto disk benchmark, so this tests the maximum speeds of a drive. So you can see that as the test starts testing larger file transfers, we can easily exceed more than 500 megabytes for both the reads and the writes, so our Patriot Blaze SSD is certainly pretty fast. So now it's time for game tests. I tried 14 different games, some old, some new, some not too old, so it's a good mix I think. And I have had plenty of experience with all of these on my personal desktop, so I do know the general performance that I get, so it's interesting to compare it to this particular machine that's much less powerful on paper. So the first game was Call of Duty Black Ops 2 multiplayer. This is personally my preferred version of Call of Duty, and you can see the settings here. So we are doing the extra texture quality with high texture filtering, 2x MSAA, ambient occlusion is on, depth of field is set to high, and everything else is no or unlimited, for the FPS at least. So once we were actually in a match, the frame rate was actually pretty good, though it did kind of dip down a bit whenever I zoom in into the crosshair section. It kind of blurs a lot of the background off a little bit, which is a bit more taxing on the video card. So what I did is turned depth of field to low, which certainly helped. So you can see that this map here played very well again. Pretty consistent frame rates throughout. One thing I did test was turning anti-aliasing off, which actually didn't increase things too much, so I just turned it back to 2xAA. Another thing that I tested was turning the texture quality from extreme down to high, and even then I got a very consistent and smooth frame rate. And here you can see some of the temperatures and the GPU load percentages and the memory usage for the video card, and they're all well within their respective ranges. The next game that I tested was Counter-Strike Global Offensive. We are running this one maxed out with 16x anisotropic filtering and 2x MSAA. So aside from increasing the anti-aliasing, this game would be considered to be maxed out. So you can see that for this particular multiplayer map, I'm easily exceeding 100 FPS at pretty much all times. So that I thought was way more than I was going to get. So again, you can see that in the temperature graph, we never really exceeded 62 degrees Celsius. And you can see that the VRAM usage was also rather low. The next game that I tested was Flatout 2 at 1920 by 1080. So we have 2x MSAA, post-processing is enabled, and we do have 16x anisotropic filtering. With the texture quality set to the max of very high and view distance set to 100, this game does perform perfectly. This game actually locks the frame rate to your monitor's refresh rate, which for my monitor, some games reported as 59Hz, while some other ones just rounded up to 60Hz. Like the other two games so far, this one isn't the newest, so it doesn't really surprise me that this plays this well. VRAM usage was rather low, and because of the FPS cap, the GPU didn't have to work as hard to give us that frame rate. Next was the original Flatout, which does give us similar graphics options, so we are running this at 1920 by 1080, 2x MSAA, and 16x anisotropic filtering. Clearly this game is not as taxing as Flatout 2, but they are both able to run at a solid 60 FPS, so if you are into these older titles, you can expect the GT 740 to perform very well. Next up is Multi-Theft Auto, which is an online multiplayer mod for Grand Theft Auto San Andreas for the PC, and the frame rate of this generally depends on the server that you join, because they do typically have a frame rate cap of maybe 30 FPS or 46 FPS or even 60. So for the server that I joined, they do have a cap of 60 FPS, and I was getting that pretty much the entire time. One thing to note is that the graphics options aren't maxed out, though they are pretty close. We aren't running any MSAA instead of very high texture quality. We're running it at just high. The draw distance isn't as high as it could be either. Otherwise, it performs very well, and I typically play this at the very high settings on my personal desktop, and to me, they don't really look any different, except for the jagged edges of not running any anti-aliasing. Next up was the newest game of the bunch, which was Grand Theft Auto 5. So I was a little bit worried about this one. I know that the older games played very well with the GT 740, but I thought that maybe the 1GB of VRAM limitation on the GT 740 was going to cripple the performance of this game. But with everything as low as they can get, at 1920 by 1080, we actually exceeded the 1023MB limit of the video memory by about 30. Everything actually played very well. The opening sequence where you're robbing the bank and then you go out to the snowy area was much better than I thought it would be, and the game still doesn't look half bad even when everything is at their lowest possible values. In this clip you can see me driving around Los Santos and the frame rate is actually incredible. Of course, everything is being run at the lowest settings. It just goes to show that even with a cheapy video card, you know, 50 to 70 bucks, you can still be able to handle the newest games. And again, I really don't think that this game looks that bad. On my personal desktop, I run this game maxed out. And even compared to this, where everything is as low as it can get, it still doesn't look that bad. I'm actually really impressed with how good this game looks at the lowest possible graphic settings. You can see that we did cap out with the VRAM, which was to be expected, and the temperatures still never really exceeded 62 degrees Celsius. So the next title is Just Cause 2, and I do believe that this game is more optimized for NVIDIA video cards, as opposed to AMD cards. But we are running everything at high or very high, with 2x MSAA and 16x anisotropic filtering. And using the built-in benchmark options, we went to the Desert Sunrise. And as you can see, the frame rate isn't too bad. It's certainly playable, and it is also pretty consistent. Anywhere from 25 FPS or so to 35 FPS. So if you don't mind those low frame rates, then it's certainly playable, maxed out. I personally think that as long as the frame rate is consistent, playing something at 20 FPS or 25 FPS isn't the end of the world. I also went ahead and turned things down a little bit, so we went from very high for everything to medium, except for the first option, which was for texture detail, since I don't think that had a medium option. We did the same benchmark again, and we went from about 30 FPS at the start to almost 50 FPS at the start, so it was definitely a big FPS bump. I also tried the concrete jungle benchmark, which was more towards the city of the map, which is actually a bit more taxing because there's a lot more happening. We get anywhere from 25 FPS to 33 FPS or so again, and I wanted to do that one again at lower options, so this time we put everything on low, but we still kept a little bit of anti-aliasing. And whenever we went too low for the texture detail, I had to restart the game, so that's exactly what I did. So the texture jungle benchmark wasn't that much improved, and really, When I adjusted all of these values, the game still looks pretty good. The overall graphics don't look too far off of what everything is when set to high. Then with everything low again, I went to the same Desert Sunrise benchmark, and the frame rate is more or less the same as when everything was on medium. The temperatures again were just fine, never really exceeding 62 degrees Celsius, and we used about half of the video card's memory. Next up was Portal 2, so once we maxed out all of the graphics options, anti-aliasing this time was set to 2x MSAA, with 16x anisotropic filtering, multi-core rendering enabled, everything else set to high. During the opening sequence, I saw no less than 60 FPS, which was great to see. Most of the time, I saw more than 100 FPS. One thing to mention is that some of the ladder levels are actually a little bit more resource intensive, so you may actually dip below 60 FPS. So for the most part, you should get a very good frame rate for Portal 2, as well as a very good gameplay experience. Next up is Project Cars, and at 1920 by 1080 with everything set to their lowest values, which includes no anti-aliasing, but I did leave anisotropic filtering to 16x, we got actually some pretty good frame rates. So for this first test, you can see that even with a total of 20 cars on the track at once, we can still easily exceed 45 FPS most of the time. And by the way, I am playing this with a keyboard as opposed to my G27, so don't judge me. But the frame rate overall for this particular track and lighting setup and everything else is actually really good. I was impressed, and the game still doesn't look half bad. I also tried out a different track with different cars and some minor time changes, so the lighting will be a little bit different. Even then, I got a very playable frame rate, no less than really, I think I saw 35 FPS with an average of just over 45, so that's really not too bad. We have just 2 to 3 more to go, and the next one is Test Drive Unlimited 2. It's not that new of a game, but I decided to try it out anyway. So you can see here that during the opening driving sequence, we get no less than, I believe, 38 FPS, averaging about 43 to 45, so that's not too bad. And once we got into an area with more buildings, the frame rate was anywhere from the low 30s to the mid 40s. Again, this is with all options maxed out except for anti-aliasing, of course, so if you wanted to get a better frame rate, you could actually just lower those graphics options and you'll be good to go. The next one is called The Crew, another driving game, and with everything set to medium, with no anti-aliasing at all, we get anywhere from 30 to 45 FPS depending on how much stuff was in view. Sometimes we dipped below 30 FPS. I also tried everything at the lowest options, and we got a little bit more of a consistent frame rate at around 35 FPS. Once we went into an area where there wasn't as much in the view at once, it went up to the high 30s to the low 40s. So considering we didn't see that much of a frame rate boost once we lowered the graphics settings even more, I think that the frame buffer or the video memory might actually be a little bit of a bottleneck here. So for the final game, I took a look at the original Test Drive Unlimited, and at 1920 by 1080, no anti-aliasing, texture settings set to high, and HDR enabled. You can see that we never really went below 60 FPS at any time, which I thought was pretty great. I remember playing this game when it first came out on a rather low-end PC, and even at the lowest settings, it just wasn't that great of a gameplay experience. And that about does it for this PC build series. So I guess to wrap everything up briefly, given what this computer has and how much it costs, I think everything performed rather well. I couldn't really be any happier with it. You do have to have reasonable expectations given the hardware and the cost for certain things, and I just think that this handled everything very well, and the fact that it can run any operating system without any issues is just another plus for it. So if you have any comments, questions, or feedback about this or anything else, feel free to leave those down below in the comments area. But that's it with the video. So thanks a lot for watching, and I'll talk to you all in the next video.